process of developing an armored fighting vehicle fit for service is never easy. More often than not, multiple experimental vehicles have to die before an acceptable design is conceived. These failed vehicles, stepping stones on the way to famous tanks, are often forgotten, their quirkiness overshadowed by the fame of their successors. However, some lucky few are able to catch a second wind and remain relatively well known despite their demise. Today we'll be investigating one such vehicle, the 75mm Howitzer Motor Carriage T18, an American self-propelled gun given a second chance at relevance by the video game World of Tanks. As one could probably guess, the T18 was far from the first domestically produced American self-propelled gun. To find the first American artillery vehicles, we have to look back to 1918 and the end of the First World War. These first designs mounted large caliber guns on the chassis of Holt tractors and were largely inspired by contemporary French vehicles. However, very few were produced due to the rather prompt end of the war. Between the World Wars, SPG development remained relatively stagnant. One notable development occurred in 1928 when a 75mm pack howitzer M1 was mounted to the chassis of the light tank T1E1 to create the 75mm howitzer motor carriage T1. But this design was never adopted. The 75mm howitzer motor carriage T3, a 1940 concept mounting the same 75mm howitzer on the chassis of the combat car M1, ended up facing the same fate. By June of 1941, with the Second World War in full swing and no modern self-propelled guns to their name, the United States Army began attempting to mount a 75mm howitzer on the chassis of the M3 Stuart Light Tank. One proposal, submitted by the Firestone Tire and Rubber Company, stood out as the most promising. It involved replacing the upper hull and turret of the Stuart with a fully enclosed cast casemate. To mount the 75mm, an M3 Lee gun mount was modified and fitted to the front left of the casemate. Impressed by what they saw, the Ordnance Committee designated this vehicle as the 75mm Howitzer Motor Carriage T18 and approved the production of two mild steel pilot vehicles in October of 1941. And after a comfortably long 7 months, the first and only pilot vehicle was finally ready for testing at Aberdeen Proving Ground. One of the T-18's most recognizable features is its boxy fighting compartment. Composed entirely of cast steel, the casemate's armor was up to 2 inches or about 50 millimeters thick. With this much armor, the T-18 would have remained relatively safe from most contemporary tank guns at range. However, the T-18's armor had some flaws, chiefly its lack of slope. Although flat armor increases the amount of available space inside the vehicle, it offers almost no supplementary protective benefits. Another issue was the vehicle's weight distribution. Because of its heavy frontal armor, the T-18's center of gravity was very far forward. This placed lots of strain on the frontal suspension and gave the T-18 a rather noticeable forward tilt. Horizontal suspension arms are a telltale sign of an unhappy tank. However, despite its issues with weight distribution, the T-18 was still just about as mobile as a standard Stuart. Both vehicles used the same engine, the Continental W679A, and had very similar weights. Even with all its added armor, the T-18 weighed only 13.5 metric tons compared to the M3's 12.7. As its main armament, the T-18 mounted a 75mm pack howitzer M1A1. Designed to be transported easily across rough terrain, this light howitzer would be used to arm quite a few American vehicles, including the LVT-A4, M8 howitzer motor carriage, and the Expedient T30 howitzer motor carriage. In its modified mounting on the T-18, the howitzer could traverse 15 degrees on each side. The howitzer's maximum elevation was 20 degrees, and its maximum depression was a measly 5. The howitzer's maximum rate of fire was about 8 rounds per minute, but it really should only be shooting about 6 rounds per minute. Within the T-18, a maximum of 42 rounds could be carried. The vehicle could fire a wide variety of shells, including the M48 high explosive, the M66 high explosive anti-tank, and the M64 white phosphorus. Each shell had a specialized purpose. The high explosive was for thin-skinned vehicles and fortifications, white phosphorus was for creating smoke screens to conceal friendly forces or blinding the enemy, and high explosive anti-tank shells were for enemy armor. The actual effectiveness of the heat shell, however, is debatable. Despite having a maximum penetration of about 3.6 inches or 91 millimeters of armor, which was more than enough for 1942, the shell's pitiful muzzle velocity of 1,000 feet per second, about 305 meters, would have made it very hard to aim beyond close range. To supplement its main armament, the T-18 was also equipped with two 30 caliber M1919A4 machine guns. Mounted in the sponsons of the vehicle, these machine guns were fixed in place, much like those of a standard early M3 Stuart. A whopping 4,900 30 caliber bullets could be carried within the T-18, ensuring that these guns would hardly run out of ammo. However, despite their endless reserves, the actual effectiveness of the machine guns was questionable. Their stationary nature meant that they could only be aimed by traversing the entire hull, making accurate fire a suggestion. In addition, while jerking the vehicle from side to side, aiming and firing the actual howitzer became impossible. It would seem that these machine guns were just a carryover from the Stuart without a second thought. The T-18 was crewed by just three tankers, a driver, a gunner, and a commander/loader. Their sole means of access to the T-18's crew compartment were two small roof hatches. However, this is only the beginning of a long list of crew discomforts. Arguably, the biggest issue with the T-18 was its lack of vision. While buttoned up, the crew's only sources of vision were the driver's forward-facing periscope and the gun sight. If this does not sound optimal, it's because it's not. With only a limited cone of vision, the T-18 would have been as blind as a bat. Flanking attacks would have turned it into mincemeat. Another problem with the T-18 was its rather suspicious lack of ventilation. Among other US tanks, multiple ventilation fans or an open top were used to quickly remove noxious gun fumes from the fighting compartment. However, the T-18 was equipped with no such amenities. The only theoretical means of allowing gun fumes to exit the casemate was opening the roof hatches. For long-range artillery duties, this wasn't an issue. However, in close-quarters combat, an open roof hatch does more than just vent gases. It gives grenades, bullets, mortar shells, and other threats direct access to the crew. Even with the hatches securely closed, the crew isn't riding happy. Continually firing the howitzer would have filled the T-18's fighting compartment with choking gases, creating what the experts would call miserable tankers. All good things must come to an end. Although the T-18 was mobile, well-protected, and featured capable main armament, the project was doomed from the start. In April 1942, a whole month before the first pilot arrived at Aberdeen for tests, the Ordnance Department decided to cancel the T-18 project. They were so confident in their decision that they didn't even need to see the performance of the physical vehicle. The main reasons cited for the vehicle's cancellation were the flatness of its armor, front heaviness, lack of vision, and poor gun traverse. After its cancellation, the T-18 pilot was presumably kept at Aberdeen and put on display. However, in 1947, many vehicles, including the T-18, were supposedly destroyed. It is at this point that any other obscure prototype would meet its definitive end. Its physical body was reduced to scrap and its story reduced to a mere footnote in AFV development history. The T-18 should have faded into relative obscurity, mentioned only in passing by dedicated authors many years down the line. However, in 2011, nearly 65 years later, the T-18 would be unexpectedly catapulted back into the minds of many tank fans. The culprit? World of Tanks. In 2011, Wargaming's MMO World of Tanks would debut its 6.5 update. In this patch, the first American tank destroyers were added to the US tech tree. In addition to recognizable vehicles like the M10 gun motor carriage and T28 Super Heavy, World of Tanks introduced a now familiar vehicle, the T-18 Howitzer Motor Carriage. Incorrectly classified as a tank destroyer, this plucky self-propelled gun quickly captured the attention of many players. The T-18 was a menace on the battlefield in those early years of World of Tanks. It was capable of one-shotting anything it could meet, was mobile enough to react to threats quickly, and had enough armor to tank quite a few shots. Although the vehicle was reclassified as a self-propelled gun in September of 2015, its infamous legacy still carries on to this day, with veteran players fondly, or hatefully, remembering their days playing with and against the T-18. This concludes our look into the T-18 Howitzer Motor Carriage, aka the Seal Clubber, a unique American self-propelled gun prototype given an unlikely second wind. If you want a more detailed account of the T-18's development and design, please check out the full article, which is linked in the description. What do you think of the T18? Was it a well-deserved failure or a misunderstood gem? In World of Tanks, do you remember playing against this thing? What vehicles do you want us to cover next? Leave your feedback down below, and as always, keep us in your sights.
If I get the first shot, if he's got a 76mm gun, then, okay. Panzer II and an SU-76, I do not like those odds. So keep moving, bounce a shot from a T-26, and here comes a derp moment. And this is what makes driving the T-18 worthwhile. Oh, T-57, Arty. I can one-shot him as well. Looks like he rushed that shot, and he's waiting to reload, and he ain't going to get the chance. Three kills.